Okay, so this will be on Bartholin-Hilkowski quantization. Okay, it's basically useful for quantizing string field theory. That's the purpose of this, but it can have more general applications, which is not necessarily within string field theory. So in a sense, we can think of this as an extension of Fadia-Popov. It's a generalized version of Fadia-Popov. Okay, it includes Fadia-Popov in particular, but it has some intrinsic differences. So let's recall what we did doing ordinary Fadia-Popov method. So here we start with some gauge theory. This is of course needed when you have a gauge theory. We start with some gauge theory. Then first we gauge x, okay, by setting some field combinations to 0. Then we introduce hosts. Okay, this is implied in the process of gauge fixing. And then finally we carry out path integral. So in Bartholin-Hilkowski, things are somewhat reversed. So here, we introduce hosts. Before gauge fixing. So in a sense, when you are introducing the ghosts, you still have the full gauge invariance intrinsic to the theory. Okay, although it appears in a somewhat non-manifest way. Then we construct something called the master action.
So in that case, if you introduce the ghost field before gauge fixing, then also the ghost field will have some transformation under the gauge transformation.
No, we'll see how exactly how you don't have the gauge transformation anymore. It gets replaced by something else. Right? We will say exactly how it is. So then we construct something called a master action, okay, which includes the original fields and the ghosts and some additional fields that we will see we have to introduce. Then we gauge fix. Okay, so at this level, this is completely general, you have not chosen any gauge. So then we gauge fix. And then finally carry out path integral.
So if we assume something like BRST, wouldn't you first do the first step then?
Which step?
If we assume that there is something like a BRST symmetry in the gauge theory.
Yeah, but the standard BRST symmetry appears in the Fadia-Popov procedure after gauge fixing. Right? You improve the gauge fixing function, then the BRST transformation loss, for example, depends on what the gauge fixing function is. Right? So here, you don't have the gauge fixing function to begin with. Right? So that's why this is different from the standard procedure. Right? At least the Fadia-Popov procedure, of course, this theory has BRST invariance, but the BRST transformation loss depends on the gauge fixing functions. So here, whatever you do up to this step is completely independent of the gauge fixing. Then only at this stage the gauge fixing becomes relevant.
Like in the ordinary Fadia-Popov following by a BRST procedure, like this, the ghosts can be thought of as the Lagrange multipliers for the gauge fixing equation.
Yes.
And then we dynamically use them in the for doing the path integral.
Yeah.
So in that sense, there is a understanding of why do I need the ghosts to implement the gauge fixing.
Yeah.
So what will be the corresponding understanding here?
Well, here we will see that this reduces to the Fadia-Popov. Right. We will start by giving the Bartholin-Hilkowski as a procedure. Okay. It reduces to Fadia-Popov in the cases which is known. Okay. But then it gives a more general framework, right, which is useful even if Fadia Popo is not applicable. Okay. So in particular, let me just say which, where it's useful. Okay, in some of these cases, Fadia Popo can be used. So this is useful for, okay, I'll just mention two examples, both of which are relevant for string field theory. First, when the algebra closes on shell, but not off shell. Which basically means that suppose you make two gauge transformations, okay, and calculate a commutator and apply it on some field. Okay. Typically, you would expect that this should be a linear combination of the gauge transformations themselves, right? Because if it forms an algebra. Okay. But there are cases in string theory and all elsewhere, okay, where you find that when you take the commutator of two gauge transformations on a field, okay, it becomes a linear combination of the gauge transformations together with equations of motion. Okay, together with transformations and equations of motion. Okay, that's what one means by saying that it closes on shell, that you have to use equation of motion to see the closure. Okay, for example, extended supersymmetries are of this kind. Okay, you have to use equations of motion to see the closure of the supersymmetry. It's also useful, okay, specially designed for cases when we have gauge invariance of gauge invariance. Okay. If we have gauge invariance of gauge invariance. Okay, so this happens typically for form fields. So let me just give an example. So suppose you have a field which is a p-form field, CP, and typically the theory of p-form fields of this kind is has gauge invariance of the form delta CP equal to p lambda p minus 1, okay, where this is a p minus 1 form. Okay, in the case of gauge field, which is a 1 form, this is the standard gauge transformation, so dA equal to, sorry, delta A equal to d lambda. But given this, we can see that not all of these lambdas generate independent gauge transformations, because if we take now delta lambda p minus 1 as d, say lambda p minus 2, where lambda p minus 2 is an arbitrary p minus 2 form, okay, changing lambda p minus 1 by this doesn't change this at all. Okay. So this is like the gauge invariance has its own gauge invariance, and this goes on. Delta lambda p minus 2 is d lambda p minus 3 and so on. Okay, and all of these have to be taken into account when you quantize the theory appropriately. Okay. If, for example, you try to do the Fadia Popo with this, write down the standard Fadia Popo Lagrangian, okay, you will find that Lagrangian has its own gauge invariance that acts on the ghost fields, okay, which you have to gauge fix again, okay, and so on. Again, BB is designed to handle those at one go.
So this second point is not an obstruction for Fadia Popo. It's just that one has to do it
exactly
everywhere.
At every step.
BB
can do it at one. Yeah, we'll see exactly how it does it. Okay. So what I'm going to do now is to give the prescription for what the BB quantization does. Okay, and we'll give the prescription by illustrating it in the context of a system with finite number of rings. Okay, and then you can generalize it to field theories, okay, which has infinite number of degrees of freedom. It's easier to write down formula with a finite number of degrees of freedom. Okay, so suppose we have a system of finite number of degrees of freedom with a system finite number of degrees of freedom which I'll call phi. Yes. An action is classified as phi. Okay, phi will stand for all the phi cases. And let's imagine that this theory has gauge symmetry. Well, gauge, of course, this is not field theory, but let's call this gauge transformation, which have the form of delta phi s is some function r s alpha of phi times lambda 1 alpha. Okay, these are the gauge transformation parameters.
Symmetry of the transformation?
You said that since we are working with finite number of degrees of freedom, but you can make it into a field theory if you just think of this as infinite number of degrees of freedom, right? So any field theory can be rewritten in this form, right? With S running over infinite number of variables. Right? So that's why I'm thinking of this as a finite number of degrees of freedom, but it's not necessary.
So alpha also runs over finite number of variables?
Yes, because we are taking only finite number of variables, but in field theory, of course, alpha will also run over infinite number of variables, right? This will include this, either the x coordinate or the momentum, if you use the momentum variable, the Fourier transform variables. Okay. Now, suppose for that, that there is a gauge invariance of gauge invariance that I just said, delta lambda 1 alpha. May have some symmetry like R tilde on alpha phi of lambda and so on. Okay, that not all the lambda tilde lambda 1 alphas may generate independent gauge transformations.
Okay.
But if you take this kind of delta lambda 1, maybe it does become zero. Delta phi s becomes zero. Okay, that's what I mean by gauge invariance of gauge invariance. So now, and this may proceed. This can be. So now, what I'm going to give you is what VV tells you to do. Okay, and only later we'll see how this is connected to Perturbation as a special case. Okay, Perturbation will come out of as a special case of VV. Okay, but I'll tell you what VV prescription is. So what to do first is that we have the field phi i's, or what did I call them? Phi s, right?
Phi s.
Yeah, we have the field phi s. For every gauge transformation parameter, okay, this is the first level gauge transformation parameter, lambda 1 alpha. Every lambda 1 alpha introduce a, well, we will call this a field. You don't have to call them ghost field right now. We will choose a field C1 alpha. And most importantly, this has opposite statistics. Opposite statistics. Lambda 1 alpha. Okay, which means that if these were bosonic transformations, if these are bosonic parameters, C1 alpha will be fermionic. Okay, if these were fermionic, C1 alpha will be bosonic. Then, for every lambda 2 m, introduce C2M But these have the same statistics as lambda 2. And so on. Okay, it alternates. Okay, the first one is opposite statistics, second level gauge transformation has the same statistics, third level is opposite statistics, and so on. So you see that as promised, we have introduced these fields without any reference to gauge fixing. Okay? We have not gauge fixed at all. Okay, all this is the prescription that we use to introduce the host fields. Okay, well, these will turn out to be host fields, but right now we are just introducing new fields. So doing this, you have a collection of fields. So phi I, this I'll be known as capital phi I. This will be the collection of all the fields that will get this. So phi s, c alpha, c2, n, and so on. Okay, so these will be what we'll call fields. Okay, in this case they are just variables. Okay, but in a field for these are fields. I think in this you cannot see anything. Okay, so these are the fields. Okay. Now you introduce for every field. Yes.
C2 has same statistics as lambda 1 or?
No, lambda 2. Because the index is of course different. Yeah?
Oh, no.
C2 has the same statistics as lambda 2 alpha. Lambda 2 m. Right? So the first level ones, right, have opposite statistics. Right? Imagine that these are the p-form field, right? So the p minus 1 form host fields, suppose it's a p-form bosonic field, right? Then p minus 1 form host fields will have harmonic statistics. P minus 2 form host fields will have bosonic statistics. P minus 3 form will have harmonic statistics, and so on.
That's right, but lambda and c would always have opposite statistics, right?
That's right, yeah. So lambdas are all bosonic. If the, yeah, if you have a p-form, then lambdas are all bosonic.
Yeah, so that's why C2M has same statistics as lambda is not correct, no?
Yeah, because C2M has the same statistics as lambda 2M. So C2M is bosonic. Because lambdas are all bosonic, right? See, if you are thinking of it as a gauge transformation of C1, then it's different, right? We are just thinking of just, okay, right now, we have not even written down the action. Right? We are just introducing the...
This is what happens to the forms. Even forms versus odd forms.
Exactly.
So they are all bosonic, but nevertheless they are both sort of kind of, you know,
alternate. Yeah. Okay. So now for every field, phi I, we introduce an anti-field phi I star of opposite statistics. Okay, this includes also the, all the original fields, the small files, as well as all the hosts that we have introduced. So now some definition. So let's suppose that we have two functions of phi and phi star, fields and antifields. So f phi star and B 5 star. So you define the anti bracket of F and G. Okay, so this is like Poisson bracket, okay, with phi and phi star being canonically conjugate variables, except that in the case of Poisson bracket, of course, Q and P have the same statistics, okay, here phi and phi star have opposite statistics.
There's nothing to do with the statistics of F and G, sir?
No, for F and G can have other formulaic statistics, this definition is always true, okay. So right and left derivatives. Refer to right derivative. So these refer to right derivative and left derivative. Okay, so when you calculate fg, this derivative acts from the right, this one acts from the left. So the derivatives always sit next to each other. Okay, this is acting from this side, this one is acting from this side. Okay, we also define delta of F as
for say ordinary scalar field.
Ordinary scalar field, there's no difference. But it can be formulaic. I have not said anywhere that what the statistics of these phi i's are, right? If they are formulaic, then you have to worry about left and right derivatives. They have different. In fact, at least one of them is formulaic, right? Either phi i is formulaic or phi i star is formulaic, because these have opposite statistics. So for one, it makes a difference. Okay, so now I introduce a master action. Master action is, which is a function of phi and phi star, which satisfies, meaning it's constructed so that it satisfies the following two conditions. The first condition is what is called the master equation. Okay, h bar is the Planck's constant, which I have not said equal to 1 here. Okay, I'll introduce this h bar soon in the path integral. Okay. So the first term, you see that it's the anti bracket of S with S. Normally, if it has a Poisson bracket, that would vanish because this is antisymmetric in F and G. Okay. But you can easily verify that as long as S has bosonic statistics, okay, this is actually not zero. This doesn't vanish. Okay, in fact, the two terms in S, if F and G are both S and if both are each bosonic, then these two terms actually give the same contribution.
So, sir, in this definition of del F, this ordering matters, right?
Yes. So because F and in general F and G can have your order different statistics. These have order different statistics. So this is the precise ordering. Okay. Now I'll leave it as an exercise to check that this implies the delta of it to be IS by H bar. This in fact is a more fundamental relation. Okay. That one needs If this is satisfied, then that means that this is satisfied. Okay, basically you have to take the derivative operation in delta and act on the exponential to figure out, to bring things down from the exponential. So the master action is required to satisfy this equation. So this is called a quantum master equation. If you set h bar equal to 0, that's a classical master equation.
This equation has a unique solution? This uniquely fixes this?
No, I have to first put the boundary condition. Okay, then you can ask. So the boundary condition on S is that S phi phi star at phi star equal to 0 is the original classical action. Notice that this is small phi. Classical action had no dependence on ghosts or anything, right? It depended only on the small phis. And the master action has to have the property that when you set phi star equal to 0, all the antifields to 0, you don't have to set all the ghosts to 0, just set all the antifields to 0, it should give us back the classical action.
So the antifield is in general a complex mixture of this C's and phi's?
So no, they are independent. Because we introduce phi's, the capital phi is the C's and phi S's. Okay? For each field, we introduce an antifield, phi star. Right? So it's only when those antifields are set to 0, okay, it should reduce back to the classical action. Okay? Even though you are not actually setting the C's to 0.
So
but the
all
dependence.
C's have a multiplication of some phi star.
Exactly. So all C's must have some multiplication of phi star.
Classical of phi s, right?
Phi s, yes. So small phi will basically mean it's the collection of phi s. The capital phi for me will be the set of all the fields, which includes the phi s's and the ghosts. Small phi will be just the original fields that we started with.
So what does the master equation with only the classical action tells me? It gives me the equation of motion?
Master action only. See, if we just use a classical action
on the master equation.
On the master equation, yeah. So then that basically means that that's a solution to the master equation. Because there's no dependence on phi star.
Right.
So obviously it satisfies all these equations.
Yeah.
Okay. Except that action you cannot gauge fix.
I see.
Meaning it's that action you cannot define path integral. Right? See, that is the problem with the classical action, right?
Hmm.
That the path integral. Okay, of course you have a finite dimensional gauge group, you can divide. Right? But when you have infinite dimensional gauge group, you cannot do the path integral. So certainly classical action is a candidate master action. Okay, except that it's not very useful because it cannot you cannot carry out path integral.
So if
s
equals to
s
classical, then the first equation is trivially solved, right?
Means
SS will be SS.
And the second equation is also trivially solved. Because there's no dependence on phi star, right? So as long as there is no dependence of S on phi star, right, both the S as well as delta S are identical. This long. Okay, so the classical action is a solution to a master equation, right, but it's not very useful because I mean you are back to the problem of gauge invariance. So yeah, I mean gauge fix. Okay, now we can also define observables. So basically you can define observable so by saying the following, that if we deform S by some small number and so any combination of the fields and antifields, okay, then this should also satisfy the delta of this is equal to 0. Okay, that's the general definition of observable. Then an observable is something that you can should be able to add to the action, okay, without destroying the general property. That should be an acceptable action. Okay. So this basically means that this equation has to be satisfied with S replaced by S plus epsilon O. So I by 2 S plus epsilon O S plus epsilon O plus H bar. is the same stuff. Okay, 0. Okay. So this is I by 2. SO plus OS plus is what they call. And I just kept all terms of order epsilon. Okay, so if you have an O like this, that declared to be not zero. Okay, now I have to introduce the notion of a Lagrangian submanifold. Okay, so now let me just say what the issue is. So we have defined S now as a function of phi and phi star. Okay, but in defining the path integral, okay, in calculating observables, we are not going to integrate over both phi and phi star. Okay, we'll have to set half the fields to zero, okay, and then integrate. Okay. And this whole machinery, okay, has been developed to ensure that the final result shouldn't depend on how you fix the fields, okay, that which fields you set to zero, okay, before you integrate, provided you choose the fields in a certain way. Okay, so let me just describe now the notion of Lagrangian submanifold, and then I'll describe how you are instructed to carry out path integral with these fields. Okay. So one simple example of a Lagrangian submanifold is set all the phi star to zero. Okay. So one example of a Lagrangian submanifold is integral d phi, that you set all the phi star to zero and you calculate d phi e to the I s by what? Phi phi star and phi star equal to zero. Okay, if you have observables, you can just put an observable. Okay, O. But the problem, of course, here, okay, is that this is easily fine because of the gauge symmetry. Okay, that was the original integral, because when you set S phi phi star, and if you set phi star equal to 0, this is the original integral. Right? Which is what you are trying to calculate. But that integral has a problem that even though it's the right integral to calculate, because of the gauge invariance, you cannot calculate it. Right? You have to factor out the sum terms, and then only then you can calculate. So the idea is now the following, that we have this analog of the phi star equal to 0 submanifold. Okay? So what we want to show is that it is possible to change this submanifold, okay, change the phi star equal to 0 submanifold to something else, okay, which does not change the value of this integral. Okay? Of course, after normalization, you have to normalize appropriately by the volume of the gauge loop. That you can change the Lagrangian submanifold, okay, or change the manifold phi star equal to 0 to something else, okay, which formally gives the same result, okay, but it gives a well-defined integral in the sense that now the gauges have been fixed. Okay. That's how you formally show that this integral that you want to calculate but you cannot, okay, is actually equal to another integral which you can calculate, okay, which is gauge fixed. Okay. So for this, now I have to tell you on what class of submanifolds you can integrate this and still ensure that the result is independent of which submanifold you have chosen.
So is it true that the statement, this path integral,
yes,
the final result is independent of choice of Lagrangian submanifold?
Yeah, if you calculate this, right, you calculate S plus epsilon O. You normalize, you calculate the ratio, because the overall volume of the gauge group factors out, right? So that, so in essence, an infinity cannot be equal to a finite quantity, but if you calculate this ratio, so this, if you change D this manifold to something else is independent of what manifold you have chosen. Provided you choose a new manifold in a certain way. Okay, and that way of choosing the new manifold is what is called a Lagrangian sum. Okay, which I will now describe. Is this point clear? Okay. So in other words, this is the integral you may want to calculate, but you cannot calculate because both the numerator and denominator have divergence because of the gauge symmetry. Okay, the gauge orbit gives you a divergent integral. Okay, not in a finite dimensional case, but in a field theory when these are actually gauge symmetries. So you have to change both the numerator and denominator, okay, to integrate over some other manifolds, okay, which do not change the result of this integral.
When we change the submanifold, we have to also ensure the measure also remains same, right?
Well, that is automatically ensured. Yeah, I'll describe exactly how we should change the submanifold, but any change of measure is compensated by this order h bar. Okay, but I mean, you have the I'll describe a change of variables, and there will be a constant that we have to impose. Yeah. Okay. A change of variables to pi I and pi I star. Okay, where put the new functions. Satisfying the following condition, such that these are like canonical transformations. Okay. But here you want to impose another condition. That's the condition on the measure. Okay. We don't necessarily have to do it, but then you have to take into account in a different way. Okay, but I'll just simplify it by imposing that anyway. These are all in the sense of waste product. So if it has a canonical transformation, then this would be automatic. Right? Because once you go from, you make it canonical change of variables, the integration measure we know doesn't change, right? DQH DQ DP is the same as DQ prime or DP DP prime if we make a canonical transformation. But here, because of the opposite statistics of phi I and phi I star, okay, that is not always guaranteed. So this is something which you impose explicitly. If we don't, then you have to worry about putting the measure explicitly somewhere else.
Ambiguity would be a sign ambiguity? I mean,
no, not just some sign ambiguity. I mean, for example, if we take phi and phi star, right, take two variables, right, and scale up phi by lambda and scale down phi star by lambda, okay, that will still continue to satisfy the anti bracket relation, right? Phi lambda phi and phi star by lambda. Yeah, their anti bracket will still be 1. Okay. But d phi star is not the same as d phi lambda phi d phi star by lambda. Because if you scale, if you remember d, if you take a Grassmann number, right, d of a lambda is 1 over 80 lambda.
Yes.
Right? So because of this, if you scale phi and phi star, suppose you scale phi by lambda, phi star by lambda, sorry, 1 by lambda, right? D phi, d phi star both get a factor of lambda. Right? If phi is bosonic and phi star is part of it. Right? So it's not just sign ambiguity. Okay? So
scaling ambiguity.
Pardon?
Scaling ambiguity.
Well, scaling, but the scaling could depend on the phi, on the functions, right? In general. So as I said, this is not necessary, but if you don't impose this, then you have to do more work. Okay, so now, given this, a transformation like this, okay, take any transformation from phi phi star to chi chi star of this kind, then chi I star equal to 0 is a Lagrangian sum I equal.
Imposition, it is only defined Lagrangian sub manifold, or like you said, that we don't need this imposition.
Pardon?
Yes. When we do this change of variable and impose that condition, like you said,
yes,
then only it's a Lagrangian sub manifold.
Yeah, otherwise you have to do okay. It will still remain a Lagrangian sub manifold because that's just a scaling. Okay, but what I'm going to do next, okay, will not be true anymore. Okay, so let me say how we should now define the integral. Then, if you want to calculate the expectation value of some operator O, okay, which is an observable, which satisfies the delta value equal to 0, then what you have to do is that you calculate integral d phi. Right, these are supposed to be capital. D phi star O to the I S by H bar can product right delta I star divided by integral d phi star to be a high case by h bar over I star. Okay, so you are now integrating over the sub manifold on which chi I star has been set equal to 0. In a special case, when chi I is phi I and chi I star is phi I star, you get back here. The original integral that you wanted to calculate. Right? Except that this integral has problem with both numerator and denominator. Right? They are infinite because of the gauge symmetry. If you are lucky, then this integral may be doable. Okay? Numerator and denominator may be finite. And the main result of the BB formalism is that this is independent of the choice of the Lagrangian sum. That means of chi I phi I star. As long as these conditions are satisfied. Okay? Make any change of variables from chi phi star to chi chi star, and then set the chi star is equal to 0, okay, then this is independent of how you have to make that choice. Okay. If you didn't impose this condition, right, suppose you just impose this and not this one, okay, then what will happen is that you have to include some additional measure factor. Okay, this delta chi I star will still be okay, right, because you chi star does satisfy this, but you have to include additional measure factor in the numerator. Okay, once you impose this condition, then this is exactly delta chi I star and delta chi I star.
So you're demanding the Jacobian of transformation to be 1.
Exactly. We are demanding Jacobian of transformation equal to 1. As I said, it's not necessary.
But we can always divide out by the Jacobian.
Yeah, but you can always divide out by Jacobian. That's what you require to put some additional measure factor. So there is a canonical choice that one makes often. That is chi I equal to phi I. Chi I star equal to phi I star minus del psi of phi. Del phi I star plus del phi I. Where this is just one order function. Okay, if it's grasp one odd, then that guarantees that this derivative has statistics that is opposite to that of phi I. So it makes sense to add it to phi I star. Okay. I'll leave it as an exercise to check that it satisfies the desired properties. All properties meaning these two. That satisfies this relation between chi I and phi I that we have introduced, that it satisfies these two. Okay, so this is a perfectly good choice for the chi I's and chi I stars. Okay. And this has the advantage that now the numerator and denominator have simple expression. Okay. So now O is given by integral d phi e to the I s times O divided by integral d phi e to the I s, and both in the numerator and denominator you just put psi star, sorry, phi star, phi I star as del psi del phi I.
Phi or
phi star? No, psi is only a function of phi. Because if it's a function of phi and phi star, then this relation will not be satisfied. Then if it's a function of phi only, then you can show that this relation is satisfied.
So just that h cross exponential, I guess.
Oh, h cross, yes.
So setting these phi I star equals to del psi del phi will automatically implement the gauge condition.
Exactly. So this psi of phi is known as the gauge formula. Right? In the BB formalism, psi of phi is known as gauge formula. Okay. So the idea is that if you set psi phi psi equal to 0, then this is the original integral. But by making psi to be non-zero, okay, you can make this integral well defined. But by the relation that the result doesn't depend on how you have made these choices of the chi i's, as long as these two conditions hold, we can ensure that this new integral is the same as the original integral.
So this psi can be s, the original s that you had, the classical s.
I think if psi is s, it probably doesn't will not fix the gauge property. The point is, not all psi will fix the gauge, right? In particular, if you take psi equal to 0, it will obviously not fix the gauge.
Now, I'm just trying to see what is the parallel between xp coordinates, normal qp coordinates, and the psi star coordinate. But the whole formalism looks very similar.
Similar, but yeah. But the point is, it's, the parallelism is not exact because it has opposite statistics, right?
Yeah.
So, because of this, right, it's not, it satisfies certain properties of the canonical transformations, but not all properties. Right? And these are not canonically conjugate variables in any way. Okay, are there questions? Okay, so this is basically what I want to discuss about a BB formalism, right? This is what the BB tells us to do. Okay. So what I'll do in the rest of the lecture is to explain how we can recover the usual Faria-Fova procedure starting with BB. Okay, because that will probably illustrate how exactly, because so far this whole procedure looks somewhat abstract, that somehow you introduce a master action. I have not told you how to construct the master action, it just satisfies certain equations. But when we try to explain how the usual Faria-Fova procedure comes in, we will see how also how to construct a master action.
This also allows to the, means in classical mechanics we also saw that.
Yeah, in classical mechanics also there is a kind of transform. But there, typically what you do is that you take psi to be a function of phi and phi star.
Ah, yes.
Right? Because if you, when you have a non-trivial canonical transformation, right, you take as a function of phi and phi star. Okay, so now I'll simplify our life by assuming that the original set of variables phi s we had, let's take them to be over. Okay, this is just so that I don't have to keep track of all the signs. Okay, but whatever I'm doing, it also hold for the formula. And you have our gauge transformation loss, delta phi s is equal to r s alpha of phi lambda alpha. The action, of course, is s classical of phi. Okay. And let's suppose that it stops here. Okay, the lambda alpha doesn't have further gauge transformation. Because if it does have, then you have to again make our life a little more complicated, introducing additional fields. So if it stops here, then the fields we know are phi s and c alpha. These are bosonic, these are fermionic. And the antifields will be phi s star and c alpha star. So these are fermionic and these are bosonic. Okay, now I have to write the master action. So let me write the master action, then we will try to verify that it satisfies the master equation. Okay. So the master action is S classical of phi plus phi S star R S alpha phi c alpha plus I by 2 f alpha beta gamma c gamma star c alpha c beta. Okay. So f alpha beta gamma, these are the structure constant. Okay. If you suppose delta alpha is the gauge transformation generated by lambda alpha. Okay. This, right? Then the commutator and the commutator of delta alpha and delta beta is given by I f alpha beta gamma delta gamma. Okay, again I am assuming here that the algebra closes off shell. Okay, because we are doing a usual Faria-Fova. Okay, we have to simplify things as much as possible, because you want to show that when algebra closes off shell, okay, this formalism reduces to the usual Fourier procedure.
Closes off shell?
Yeah, that this is true without using equation of motion. Yeah, that when you apply this on a field, right, it's equal to this without any additional equation of motion. So now you have to verify that this satisfies the required conditions. The second condition is easy to verify. Okay? The second condition was that when the anti-fields are set to 0, it should reduce back to classical action. Okay? And you can indeed see that when you set phi s star and c gamma star equal to 0, you get back the s classical of phi. Okay? So the second part is more or less trivial.
This is linear in phi star, right?
No. Because in general it is not.
Change this to chi star, then it will become...
Yeah, in general it is not linear in phi star. In this particular case...
You begin with this and then...
Okay, in this case upon it, this follows a master action.
Yeah.
Right? In general, when the algebra doesn't close off shell, right, you have to add more terms here.
Yeah, but even if... Now if I change it to chi star, if I do...
So you can. I'm just saying this is a solution to the master action. Of course, starting from here, right, you can make these canonical transformations. Right? Change phi and phi star to chi and chi star in a complicated way, and that will have more complicated form. Okay? Right now, we are trying to get one solution to the master action, right, and then we will see how by gauge fixing we recover the usual Fourier port procedure. So, this is certainly not the unique solution, because you can always make canonical transformations of the kind that I described, right, to get more general master action. Okay, so now let's calculate the anti bracket SS. And in this case, there are two terms, but one can easily check that this is given by twice del L S del phi S. Let me write in terms of capital 1 first. Del R. This is L. Okay, the second term is the same as the first term. Okay, this is when S is bosonic. Okay, when S is formulaic, there is a different factor. So this is, so let me put the half on this side. Minus, as I said, is equal to this, okay, in this particular case. Because other term would have been a phi star here and phi there, right? But because they are both S, right, you can check that it gives the same result.
So then you know cos squared,
like,
phi
is C alpha
squared.
No, because phi I star, right?
Oh, phi I star.
This has to be the same. Then normally one should have written it as phi I lower and phi I star upper. Right? Then the contraction would have been clear, but it doesn't matter. Is this okay? So let's now calculate this a little carefully. So this one is del S, del phi S. Right? This first term. It doesn't matter whether it is from left or right, because phi s is bosonic anyway. Del s classical, del phi s. But there is another point, another term where it comes in, which is phi s star. let me write it as so let's change this to R. I'm changing the index to R. And maybe this alpha also I'll change to tau because alpha is being differentiated, right? Just to change of level because of the fact that I'm going to use this S. Okay. So phi R star. Then I'll write as del S R R alpha. Phi C alpha. The last term doesn't depend on phi. And then the this one is del L S del phi S star. Okay, that's easy to calculate. This is just R S beta C beta. This clear? Now the second term, L is del C alpha. Left derivative coming from del R, right derivative coming from this set that just removes the C alpha. So phi R star R alpha. Phi R star. Plus C alpha, so beta becomes alpha, right? And the 2 goes away. So I left beta alpha gamma, so tau alpha gamma. And then C alpha star, so basically tau becomes alpha times I by 2 if alpha beta gamma, I should call something else probably. So what do I do? Sorry, gamma becomes alpha, right? So tau beta alpha. Change the index somehow, right? This should call this is it okay? The important point is that this del del C alpha star, right? So this gamma has to be put equal to alpha, right? These indices I just change to whatever I like, sigma and delta I change. So sigma delta, sigma delta. Okay, so that there is no repeated slope index. Is this clear?
Yes.
Okay, now some terms here vanish. So let's get rid of those first.
Right?
Yes.
So when I differentiate, don't you get two terms with different signs?
Yes, you will get two terms with different signs, but they actually have the same sign because R, this F also has an anti-symmetry, right?
Yeah.
So because of that, you get the same sign. Okay, now let's look at this. Del S classical del phi S R S beta C B.
Del S classical del phi S R S beta C B.
This is zero. Okay, why is this zero? Because S classical is supposed to be gauge invariant, right? So if S classical is gauge invariant, that means del S classical del phi S times delta phi S must be zero, right? But delta phi S is R S beta of phi times lambda beta. Yes, lambda beta is completely arbitrary. It has arbitrary parameters. So this means del S classical del phi S times R S beta must be zero. Right? So that means this is zero. So this is equal to zero. Is this clear? Okay, so this term then we can get it up. This one, let's look at this one. If tau alpha gamma, if sigma delta alpha, f of course is anti-symmetric, so you can do whatever you like with it. This is kind of moved around. C comma star C tau C sigma C delta. So what is the structure? One index is contracted. And after one index is contracted, there are four free indices. And this one, totally anti-symmetric, is three of the four indices. That makes this vanish just by Bianchi identity. And you are assuming that this is ordinary algebra, closes on shell, closes off shell, so this is zero by Bianchi identity. Jacobian, yes. So it has the same structure. Okay. So now we are left with these two terms, which you have to worry. Okay, this term and this term. So let's look at this term over here, phi r star, r is beta of course is this is bosonic, right? So I can put it anywhere I like. So let me write it as r is beta phi. L is R alpha of phi C alpha C beta.
This will be like del del phi is
this. Pardon?
R del R.
Yes. So let's see what this is. This R alpha of phi is basically delta alpha of phi r, right? This is delta alpha of phi r, alpha of phi r, right? This one, this is the change in phi s under delta beta, but we are differentiating this with respect to phi s and multiplying by the change, right? So this object is actually delta beta of this one, right? Because this is a change, this is taking derivative with respect to phi s, and this is delta phi s under beta, right? So this is delta beta phi s, right? So delta beta phi s times delta phi s of something is delta beta of that object. So this is delta beta delta beta alpha phi r, right? Delta beta delta alpha phi r times c alpha c beta. Yeah, but now because this is anti-symmetric, I can replace it by half the anti-commutator of delta beta and delta alpha. Is clear? So this is then half I f beta alpha gamma delta gamma phi r c alpha c beta.
Yeah.
So this is delta alpha phi r, right? R r alpha phi. What is r r alpha? It's delta phi r, right? As r r alpha times lambda alpha, right? Lambda alpha is a parameter, right? Its coefficient what I'm calling delta alpha. So this is delta alpha phi r. This one r s beta is delta beta of phi s.
Yes.
For the same argument, right? So this is delta beta of phi s times del del phi s of this.
Okay.
Right? So if you take derivative with respect to phi s and multiply by delta beta of phi s, that's like the delta beta of that object.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So because of this, I can write this as delta beta of delta alpha phi r. Right? Because this was delta alpha phi r. Right? And now you now apply delta beta on it. Is this point clear? Then I use the algebra to replace it by half I f beta alpha gamma delta gamma phi r. Now delta gamma phi r is just r r gamma of phi. Right, so then this term becomes half I f beta alpha gamma r gamma of phi c alpha c beta.
Will be a phi r star.
And yes, and then the phi r star system. Okay, and if we have done things correctly, then that exactly cancels this term. Okay, I think you have to probably change the indices around a little bit, otherwise you may have to change the sign in the original term. Okay, whatever it is, I think this is correct, because this is gamma can be brought in the front, right? That's like there.
Might be a mismatch of I.
No, I is there. I is there here, I is there here also.
But it's multiplied with an I.
No, this is the owned by Jacobi. I'm looking at this term.
Sorry.
This. This doesn't have an I. Right? So I think this is okay, because this is in the order sigma delta. Right? Sigma delta. Right? Alpha of course can be statically brought here. And here it's beta alpha, but here it's alpha beta. Right? So I think they have a relative minus sign, so these two terms cancel. So that basically shows that SS is 0. So the result is that SS is 0.
Delta and alpha beta in the reverse order, so that's why.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, now delta is, you can calculate. Delta S is then so this is del R, this is capital, this is phi, right? So that is del R, del phi S, del L S, del phi S car plus dr del c alpha del ls del c alpha star. Okay, I have erased the expression for s, but you can check that this one involves f alpha alpha gamma basically. So which is 0 by the anti-symmetry of f alpha gamma. Okay. So there is a term in s which depends on c and c star. Okay, the last term that I wrote. Okay, but when you calculate del C star, you just get F alpha alpha comma. This one is a little more tricky. So this gives you del del phi S of R S alpha of phi C alpha. Okay, this again you can check from the, basically you have to look at the term which has both phi and phi star, right? So is this zero? Okay, that's the question, because you have to make, in order to show that S is master, satisfies master action, we have already shown that S is anti bracket is 0, so you have to show that this is 0. So here you have to be more specific and use the more standard form of phi of gauge transformation that we use in standard gauge theory, which is a linear gauge transformation. Right? So R S alpha in typically the delta phi S, right? R S alpha has a form of phi alpha S P phi T. Okay, let's take that form. Okay, this is a transformation change in phi under a gauge transformation generated by lambda alpha, right? So the standard form that you take in normal gauge theory is that you have a generator which acts linearly on phi. And this typically is an element of On. If phi belongs to some, if there are n phi's all together, right, you take a unitary representation, so it's a generator of On. So then del del phi S of R S alpha will basically give you T alpha S S. Okay, and this is 0. Because of the tracelessness condition, right? Since when generators are traceless.
So, what about if I write phi as some rho e to the power I theta and then take theta to theta plus c? Basically, nonlinear realization.
Yeah, well, in that case, of course, the it's a constant, so the derivative will be 0.
This may be the easiest nonlinear generalization, but there are.
Yeah, so in general, the point is that, I mean, you can ask what if we take a symmetry, right, which is a scaling of phi.
Yeah.
Right? That's the simplest case where it will fail, right? It's not an element of On. The phi goes to a lambda phi, right? So then that shows that there, delta of S is not 0. So you have to add something to delta S. Okay? And that's expected because if the symmetric transformation that we are considering involves a scaling, right, then the major is not invariant, right? And this delta S term precisely accounts for the non-invariance of the major. Right? So the BV knows already, okay, about what to do with the major. Right? If the major is not invariant, then BV tells you that we have to add something else. Right? So the fact that if delta S fails to be 0, right, then you have to compensate for it by adding something to S. And that's a reflection of the fact that if we have a nonlinear transformation, then the measure, the standard measure that we use, may not be gauge invariant. Right? And that's what this is showing. Right? If it's a linear transformation of the kind I am taking, then that's d phi I is a gauge invariant measure. So you don't expect any problem. understand. But for a general nonlinear transformation, just standard d phi may not be gauge invariant measure. Okay. So these terms in S that you have to add, right, which accounts for the delta S. If you have to add such terms, typically they reflect that without those terms, the original measure was not gauge invariant.
Of SS equal to 0 didn't require this
stresslessness
condition.
So, because that is a classical BV, that doesn't have H bar. Okay. That's why that doesn't know anything about the measure. Okay. What knows about the measure is this delta S part. Right? And this is important in string field theory, because in string field theory, in fact, because of this delta S, you have to keep adding new terms in the action of our H bar or of our H bar square and so on. Okay. And those basically reflect the fact that without adding those terms, your original measure was not gauge invariant. Okay, here the reason that we didn't, that delta S condition is satisfied trivially, is precisely because of the fact that your measure is gauge invariant, right? As long as the transformation laws are linear.
So means in that case, in those cases, we'll have to take the master action to be something else.
Exactly, you have to add something more to the master action to make delta S equal to 0. That, or SS plus delta S equals 0. Right? You basically add something more to the master action of order h bar, so that SS gets a contribution of order h bar, right? And that you use to cancel against the delta s bar. Okay, are there questions? Okay, so finally then, so this gives the master action for the standard gauge theory. Okay. Now, we have to see how we can get Fourier Popov gauge fixing out of this, right? Which basically means that I have to tell you how to choose my chi and chi star, okay, and then set chi star to 0 to get the standard Fourier Popov. Okay. So you have to make a change of variables from the original phi's to some chi, right? And then set the chi star to 0, right? Insert delta chi star. Okay. So this I am going to do in two steps. Okay. The first step, so our original variables are phi s, c alpha, and their anti brackets, right? Phi s star, c alpha star. We are not going to do anything about C alpha and C alpha star. Okay, they will remain exactly as it is, so that eventually C alpha star will be set to 0. Okay, because all the antifields are set to 0. Okay. But we are going to make some transformation involving phi and phi star. Okay, and this will be done in two steps. The first step is to introduce chi hat S equal to Fs. Okay, so these are some arbitrary functions. Okay. Let me now write down the number of fields. Okay. Suppose S runs from 1 to n, and I will take alpha to run from 1 to m, and m should be less than n. Okay, because you don't want all the fields to be pure gauge, right? Alpha is the number of gauge transformation parameters. M is the number of gauge transformation parameters. N is the number of fields. So you want the number of fields to be more than the number of gauge transformation parameters. Okay, so I take M to be less than N. Okay, so I make a transformation like this, chi hat S to Fs of phi. And I take chi hat S star to be let's call this M S R of phi, phi R star. Where M is R of phi del R of Ft gradient X. Namely, M is R is the inverse of this matrix del R Ft. So I can also reverse this to write this as phi r star equal to del r f s of phi minus star. Okay. And I impose finally another condition: the determinant of del r f s phi equal to 1. Okay, so the f's are not all independent. Okay, it is a condition that we make change of variables which preserve the measure or phi.
Can't there be
free
configurations where this del r of f is vanish at some points?
Well, then it's not a well-defined transformation. Then we'll assume the del r of fs doesn't vanish at some point. In fact, the last fs we'll choose such that it doesn't vanish. Okay. Now I'll leave it as an exercise to check that this is a canonical transformation. Check that this is an allowed transformation. Okay, in fact, just to check that the chi is that the anti brackets okay, of the chi that are the correct ones, you don't need this. Okay, this determinant condition you need only to check that the measure remains unchanged. And in fact, with this determinant condition for these transformations, you have some stronger condition. That I equal to 1 to n d phi I is I equal to 1 to n d phi I hat. Sorry, I call this S, right? S. And S equal to 1 to n d phi A star is product S equal to 1 to n d phi hat S. This is clear, right? Because of this determinant condition, right? The individually the phi's preserve the measure and the phi stars preserve the measure. Okay, of course, this is a very special kind of transformation, right? We see that the transformation that we have taken, the phi's only makes it chi's, right? Phi's become chi's or chi hats.
Writable in that form that you wrote phi star minus del psi of
no, phi. No. That was a special case. In general, this is not writable in that form. Right? But that's not, that was a special case. It's not necessary, right? To go from BB to Fadia Popov by direct route, right? We cannot use that kind of gauge fixing. We'll be using different kind of gauge fixing. Okay. But chi hat is not good enough for us. So let me now make another change. So the idea is that now, for the first m of these variables, we are going to switch the definition of chi hat and chi. Sorry, chi hat and chi hat star. Okay, the star and so I'll now define chi s is equal to chi s. Sign by k. And then for the rest, chi s is chi hat s. Chi s star is chi hat s star for s equal to n plus 1. Yeah. Okay, this also preserves the required conditions. Yeah, this is like changing coordinates at the moment. Okay, and the major condition is trivially satisfied. Now we are in business, but let me just write down the expression for S once more. S or S classical of phi plus phi S star or S alpha of phi C alpha plus I by 2 F alpha beta gamma C gamma star alpha C beta. Okay. So now my path integral so d phi i star you know right then this then we have product alpha equal to 1 to n dc alpha product alpha equal to 1 to m dc alpha star o to the I s by a bar. And now I have to include the delta functions, right, which are the gauge fixing conditions. Delta functions will be all the chi stars. Okay, all the chi stars will be set equal to 0. So let's do this one by one. So first of all, the chi stars for s equal to 1 to m are the chi hat s's. Okay, now what is chi hat s? That is fs of phi. Okay, maybe I write it here first. Okay. So, S equal to 1 to n delta chi hat S star product alpha equal to 1 to n delta C alpha star. Right? Okay, just
chi S.
Chi?
Yes.
Sorry, chi S star. Chi S star. Now this let's leave it as it is. I want to expand this out. So from s equal to 1 to m, for the first m, chi s star is minus chi hat s, which in turn is minus fs of phi. So I can write this as delta of fs of phi. Yeah. Then product s equal to m plus 1 to n delta chi s star, right? Chi s star for s equal to 1 to m, like this. These are, this should have been S, not I, right?
Yeah.
And then product alpha equal to 1 to m delta C alpha C.
Somehow you want to show that this actually reduces to delta phi S star equals to 0, like that.
Yeah, so let's. No, we don't want to show that it is equal to delta phi s star. What I am going to do is, we are going to change this. We have to, we have this relation over here, right? We are going to change the measure. This will replace by product s equal to 1 to n delta chi hat s star. Sorry, b chi hat s star. No problem, right? It's okay. So now we are going to use this delta function to set some of them to zero. It's okay. You see that these can be used to remove the integration over chi hat a star, okay.
This delta function should also be chi hat s.
This should also be chi hat s, right? Yes,
yeah.
Thank you. Because we have.
So you put chi s equals to chi s.
Yeah, chi s star is chi hat s, right? For
s equals
to. Yes. Okay. So using this, I can now set, make this integral running from s equal to 1 to m, and the rest are all set to 0. Okay, so let me write this here. I think the far top line I don't need anymore, so this I can erase. Okay, but I need the rest of the relations. So I am left with integral product s equal to 1 to n d phi s, and let me write the delta functions there. Product s equal to 1 to m delta f s phi. Okay. So you already see that part of it we have got. Okay. We have that integral over the, all the d phi s's, but we have put m gauge fixing conditions, right, in the form of fs of phi. Okay, the first m of these fs's are now acting as a gauge fixing condition. Then we have integration over product I equal to 1 to m b chi hat s star. The rest I set to 0 by using this. So this has been taken care of. This has been taken care of. C alpha star I just used to set the this to 0. Okay. So just product alpha equal to 1 to m d c alpha. Then I have my O and it will be I s by A. So O an exponential I by h bar, okay, and now we have to be little careful. So the first is S classical of phi. Okay, this is there, S classical of phi. Then I have to use this, but phi a star doesn't exist as an integration variable, right? I have eliminated phi a star in favor of chi a star, chi at a star, right? Okay. So let's look at this equation over here. Because our integration variables are chi at a star, right? So I should use this, and you see from here that chi at a star, some of the chi at a stars have been set to zero, right? From m plus 1 to n. So phi r star, so phi a star becomes del s f, let me call it f r of phi chi hat r star, but the sum over r runs from r equal to 1 to m. Okay? That I express the phi r star back in terms of chi a star, right? Where other chi s's are 0. And then what we have? R s alpha. R s alpha phi c alpha. And the last term is 0 because c gamma star we have set equal to 0. Basically, this is what the Faryapova will give you. Okay, I just have to write in a slightly organized way. So this is integral product s equal to 1 to n d phi s, product s equal to 1 to m delta of s phi, then product s equal to 1 to m chi s at star, product alpha equal to 1 to m dc alpha o exponential I over h bar. First is s classical phi plus, let me just write this chi r star, I'll pull outside. So chi r star del s of fr of phi r s alpha, this sum over r runs from 1 to m, r s alpha c alpha. Okay. So this I claim is exactly what the Faryapova procedure will give you. Okay, if you had started with the Faryapova procedure and use the gauge fixing functions as fs of phi from s equal to 1 to m. So the interpretation is that the c's are the usual ghosts, these are the anti-ghosts. Yeah, they are m in number, they came from a quite different source, right? They came from actually the anti-fields of the field. Okay, these are the anti-ghosts in the usual Faryapova procedure. So here you have, see, the anti-ghost. The kinetic term, if you remember how you construct it, you take the gauge fixing function fr and calculate its variation under a gauge transformation alpha. Right? This is exactly that. R s alpha times delta s del s fr is delta alpha of fr of phi. Then you are calculating the variation of fr by using gauge transformation with lambda alpha. So that's the kinetic operator, then you multiply it by c alpha. So this way you can see that starting from BV, right, and doing appropriate gauge fixing, you get to exactly what the Fadi-Apura procedure was supposed to give you. But of course, this is in the special case when the gauge algebra closes on shell, right, and the master equation is satisfied trivially, right, namely the anti-bracket of SS is 0 and delta S is 0. Okay, that's the case where the BV, where the Fadi-Apura works nicely. And there, BB and Fadi-Apura are identical.
Why did we use that the algebra closes off-shell?
Well, if the algebra didn't close off-shell, then the master equation would not have been satisfied. Right? Because we use that delta alpha of delta beta, commutator acting on phi r is f alpha beta gamma. Right? That wouldn't be satisfied if there are additional terms. Right? If the transversal equations of motion, then that would fail. Okay, so I think that's it for the Fadi-Apura for BV. Okay. So now, I mean, maybe we want us to have one more lecture for application of BV formalism to string field theory. Okay. We'll see if we can make it on Thursday, otherwise it has to be after I come back. In the meantime, you have to read up string field theory, whatever I did. Basically, it will be a, I mean, simple generalization of what we had already done in the class, right? But to show that the master action is, master equation is satisfied by the string field reaction.